Hey guys, Cuiv the Lazy Geek here and welcome back to the channel. The time has finally come. I am going to be able to test the Dwarf Lab Dwarf 2 telescope under the stars. Finally. So I've been waiting and waiting until I could finally test this little thing under the stars. And I did do like tests inside, that kind of stuff as much as I could, but I wasn't really able to get a good idea of how it would perform. At least I was able to ask questions to Dwarf Lab while I was waiting for the skies to clear at night, because they were often clear during the day and cloudy at night, as it should be. And so I was able to read like a blog post from Dwarf Lab about how to perform astrophotography. I was able to update the firmware and the app on the smartphone. I was able to ask questions and to get ready for this night, which, fingers crossed, will work okay. So later tonight, actually, it's planned to be raining. Actually, weirdly enough, even though it's very clear right now, as far as I can tell. So I'm not going to be able to test today the astrophotography part of this telescope. What I will do for sure is test out the initial astrophotography features, which should be mostly the go-to features, effectively. So how the telescope can orient itself, if it has an alignment procedure, which from what I read it does, and how well it performs go-to centering of objects, and then stacking of those objects from like an electronically assisted astronomy point of view first. Quick disclaimer, if you're just joining this channel, I'm in Tokyo, in Japan, so it's a very, very bright area. I have a lot of light pollution, so what you're about to see is really the worst case scenario for this telescope. Worst case scenario will be checked today, and later on, if I like what I see, I'll be carrying it out under the stars of darker areas not far from Tokyo. So we'll see. So the first thing will be the calibration. Now, from what I read of the calibration, is what's going to happen is I need to first like set an angle for the lens like in the altitude direction. So, and it will keep that angle. It will not change the altitude during the calibration. So I choose an angle and I put it on the home notch here, and then it will take like maybe 40 degrees to the left here, 40 degrees to the right, and it will compute like how it needs to perform go-to. I assume it will compute also like how horizontal it is. And you know, my tripod is a terrible tripod that I'm using right now, so it's definitely not horizontal, and which is great. It's going to be part of the stress test to see how well the tracking goes. Okay, and one of the other negative points that I've noticed talking with Dwarf Lab is I was asking like, can we get longer exposures than 15 seconds? And the answer is no. And that's a limitation apparently of the sensor assembly itself. So we have up to 15 seconds exposures, which for me in Tokyo doesn't really matter, because anyway, my optimal exposure time is probably going to be around 1 second in typically because of my huge light pollution. But you know, if you're in a very dark zone, it might be a bit like, oh, I wish I could do longer. But you also have the fact that it's in alt-az mode, so you're limited by the field rotation anyway. So I guess it's a compromise that's acceptable. Now going back to the calibration, because during the calibration it will not change the angle here of the altitude, it means that if I select a high angle like this, it will take 3 points that are very close to one another, so I assume the tracking accuracy will be bad afterwards. If I pick too low of an angle, it might hit some buildings, and that might have some problem with the calibration. So I need to find like a Goldilocks kind of zone. I think this angle, something like that, I guess like 30, 40 degrees will be good enough for me. But really, Dwarf Lab, I think you want to have like a manual kind of calibration available for people who have balconies with lots of obstructions, right? Because then I could use the software joystick that we saw in the last video to point to one area, tell the Dwarf Lab, okay, take your first calibration frame, point to a second area, again via the joystick, tell the telescope, and then a third one. And that way you can work around any obstructions that you have. That would really be much better, in my opinion, than having a single automated calibration, especially if you're gearing this scope towards more like amateurs or people with less understanding of the night sky. You might have some people starting like that. They will get very poor calibration. Let's get started. Let's go. I'm going to turn off the lights. Okay, here we are. My guess is the autofocus of the camera will have some trouble here, but hopefully it's going to work. I am going to turn on the telescope. And by the way, something I noticed in the software and in the way that it works is that if you put yourself in astro mode, the big ring light here will turn red, which is good. And you can also turn off the LEDs here in the settings of the telescope. So you can, and you can turn off the top one as well. So you can turn off everything so you don't get any light leaking from the telescope, which is great for star parties because you're not going to be popular at star parties if you have a big green light that is blinding everywhere and everyone. Okay, I'm now in the app. Let's connect to the camera. At least the camera seems to be recognized, so that's a good first step. Okay, and we are in the telescope. So one of the things also that I noticed from reading documentation and talking with Dwarf Lab is that there is no good star autofocus yet. So the autofocus on stars will not work well, which is why I did my homework. During the day, I pointed the telescope as if at a faraway object, so like a faraway building in my case, and I focused there. So to do the focus, I just like, you know, click the focus button and then pressed auto, and then it you know, it just adjusted itself to focus on that building, nothing for me to do. That's the only thing that I did, but that was preparation. And that means that once I look at the stars, I should see points of light. If I haven't done that previously, I'll need to use very long exposures to first see the very wide rings that are very faint for stars that are out of focus, and then play with this to get the stars in focus. So really, that's another thing we need, like, especially for beginners, it's gonna be very important for Dwarf Lab to set up a proper star autofocus that can work from anywhere the focus is at. So Dwarf Lab, you need to have like an idea of where your infinity focus is for each of the scopes. You can place the focus there, and then you can run a curve-based, HFR-based star autofocus. One of the things, by the way, since last time that changed, we have the Astro Dark mode where it will take dark frames automatically. I tried that inside, and I deleted the dark frames because I want to first try without any dark frames. And if I'm going to do astrophotography in the end, I just want to use my own manually taken dark frames. So I'm going to ignore this for now, and we're going to go into Astro mode. And right now I don't see any stars, so I think what I'm, you know, I could try to adjust the stuff here. So we have like the IR cut filter is on. That's not good. It should be off automatically for Astro. We have a small gain, and we have an automated shutter speed that seems to be quite fast. So that's not great, but let me try. Actually, let's see what happens if, leaving the settings, being a complete beginner, I go into the features and click calibration. Will it, oh, it adjusted itself and the stars are in focus. Okay, the stars are in focus, which means, or at least fairly well in focus, which means that my focusing during the day on a distant object seems to have worked well. If I hadn't, I'm pretty sure that this would be failing completely because the stars would be out of focus. But since I can see the stars, it means that it has adapted the settings. That is good. That is good. Good point. Very good, Dwarf Lab. Good. Way to go. Okay. And we have first calibration, second calibration. This is fast. Is it already done? And it's really not horizontal. Whoa, I don't know how well that's gonna work because it's really not. Calibration success. Okay, and I see the stars seem to be quite fixed in the screen. Okay, that was quick. Okay, so that alleviates quite a bit the problem that of the dead angle or the view angle that you're not able to reach, because you could just like move the telescope, redo the calibration since it's so fast. Okay, that's okay, that's fair enough. Okay, so we might have a thin layer of clouds. Okay, we have a thin layer of clouds probably. Yeah. Okay, anyway, but we're gonna try anyway. So right now, I think one of the best ways to beat light pollution and a very thin layer of clouds is to go for something that's close to the zenith. And right now, the Andromeda galaxy should be very close to the zenith. So let's try that. Let me first see what happened to the settings. Ah, okay, so now it went to IR pass, which is what you want to be for astrophotography. So that's good. And gain 100, it's exactly as they said in their blog, and shutter speed of 1 second. That's good, it's good. I feel like it should be like automated the moment you go into the astro mode. Let us try to go to M31. Okay, so one other change here, which is neat, is that we have, I think we have much more catalog items that we than before, than during my unboxing video. So this is good. Also, we don't have like the Chinese names as well, so it's properly separated. Okay, so let's confirm. How well will the Goto to the Andromeda Galaxy work, and how long is it going to take? So the stars start drifting immediately. So it seems like it disabled the Goto first. And okay, I see the Andromeda Galaxy. It's not centered yet. Will it center it? And the stars are drifting. I hope it's not finished. Oh, okay, it's centered. Oh, Goto tracking. Hey, good. That was fast. Okay, that is good as well. There's a lot of things that need to be enhanced, we can tell already, but the core functionality seem to be sound. Let me remove the wide field camera. Okay, so I'm now going to go to more, and there's been another change that Dwarf Lab told me about. The format has been fixed to TIFF for astrophotography because their FITS implementation apparently is not perfect yet, and they don't want people to select JPEG when they're in the Astro mode. Okay, that's fair enough. Also, the binning has been fixed to 2x2, which reduces the resolution by a factor of 4. Okay, it's not great, especially since we have such a low focal length at first, but for electronically assisted astronomy, I think it's fine. I told them they should provide us the option to put the billing to one by one for people who are going to do serious astrophotography, or like semi-serious astrophotography with this device. And they said okay, so I assume they're going to do that at some point. Okay, and let's say, okay, first I'm going to actually set the shutter speed to 10 seconds. We have a thin layer of clouds and the light pollution, so I don't want to go like up to 15. And we're gonna see how well the tracking works. So the stars are not quite pinpoint, okay. They're a bit elongated. The tracking is not perfect. I wonder if the tracking, how much dependent on a good calibration the tracking is. I would say very. Which means that it might be able to be enhanced in software. And you know, like Dwarf Lab, you have a very important tool here. You have a wide angle lens. If you're able to access that wide angle lens while you're tracking, you could have the wide angle lens pinpoint a star and follow that star, so that you could have effectively auto-guiding that is done by the wide angle lens for the longer lens. I don't know if it's possible, but it sounds like it is possible to me, and that would be a great thing to add so we don't have any tracking errors. But now that I look at it, yeah, it's still elongated, so we're not getting perfect tracking. Let's try to take something like, what, 25 frames, so 250 seconds. Maybe let's do 5 minutes. 5 minutes of stacking, confirm. And so I am going to press now the record button, which should start the astrophotography, or at least the electronically assisted astronomy. Let's see what happens. Okay, it's starting. At the top of the screen, I see like stacked zero, current zero. So it's now taking the exposures. Okay, it started to stack, which is good. So next step for me, I'm going to click on features, and this is something that I saw on their blog as well. We need to manually adjust the histogram to make it look as good as possible, which I think is too bad. I wish we could just like have an unlinked stretch like I've implemented in Nina, or like we have in PixInsight. Then like I wouldn't have to play with that. But I can see M31, which is already very good, and I can see M33 as well at the bottom of the frame here. So that's it's a good start. Okay, so if I do a simple S curve, I'm starting to see more. It's far too red, so I'm gonna, oh, nice. Can I, oh nice, we're starting to see something there. We really should have a better auto stretch by default, but I'm actually already getting impressed, because we're only like 100 seconds in and we are getting the full galaxy, including the first like two dark bands in the galaxy arms. So this is actually, wow, this is nice. Now the colors are not great, and really we need an unlinked stretch. Guys, give us an unlinked stretch. This is critical. You have such potential in this product. And I feel like the software can make it so much better. Actually, I'm gonna say something. Make the software open source. If you make the software open source, I'll definitely be contributing to it. Oh, this is good. We're getting to see more and more of the galaxy. Oh, it's funny. We can see the walking noise because we're not using any dark frames. This is funny. So for me, for a geek like me, this is actually super cool. And we're getting more and more of the galaxy. Guys, this is actually really good. And we are now at 19 frames stacked over 3 minutes. And it's for just 3 minutes of data from Tokyo. Color me impressed. Color me red as well, because it's far too red. But color me impressed. Let's wait until it's done with the 30 frames. Okay, so while we were imaging, of course my main camera, this guy here, decided to run out of battery, even though it had indicated full at first. Classic camera. But something very interesting happened. If you look at the screen right now, it's black, I don't see anything. And what happened is that the moment we got like the last frame stacked, so the 30th frame stacked, the stacked frame just like disappeared. And instead of this, I got this. And if I look into the settings, we're back to IR cut, gain zero, shutter speed auto. It's like, it's weird. It's back to wrong settings. And that's not good. I would want to look at my stacked image and play with the histogram, even after the stack has ended. So that's another thing that needs to be enhanced. Let's click on album and see what's in there. Okay, so at least I can open it here and look at it here, but I don't have access to the histogram anymore. So yeah, that's a problem. I think that if I go back here and I go back to Goto and I just like go again to M31, okay, it restores the proper setting for astrophotography. But this is less than ideal. This is not a great user experience. And this is another thing that needs, I believe, to be fixed. At least it recentered M31, so it's back in business. Seems to be working, and we'll see whether the Goto gets activated correctly. Yeah, it does. So that's good. At least I can see that this is good. For the size, weight, price, it's really good, and I hope that Dwarf Lab keeps the supporting and enhancing the software. Would I be buying this with my own money for Christmas if I could get it for Christmas? You know what? Probably. I want to test it like under the stars of less light-polluted skies. But yeah, I mean, this is already giving me like a really good vibe overall, even though, as we can see, like the interface is still quite clunky in a lot of respects. But, you know, it's for you to judge based on my first impressions here. Tons of enhancements to be done, but I think there is a solid foundation. So what I'm going to do next is take something like 30 minutes of data on M31, and I'm going to try to stack them in PixInsight, and we'll see how well that goes. I'm so surprised by the results that I'm getting. Okay, quick background. I caught 141 10-second frames before the clouds rolled in. So that's 23.5 minutes, according to my calculator, because I couldn't compute that in my head. And let's see in PixInsight what this looks like after just stacking. And I also took 10 dark frames, by the way. Just 10 dark frames manually. And let's use an unlinked stretch. And by the way, again, Dwarf unlinked stretch, you really need to implement this. Anyway, boom, there you go. This is from Tokyo. Okay, the tracking is not great, but look at this. Look at this. The galaxy is there. This is from Tokyo. How? In 20 minutes. On an uncooled sensor. That's really good. Now, one of the fun things that Dwarf Lab had told me is that because the optics are so well matched to the sensor, you don't need flat frames. Yeah, you do. I didn't take flat frames, but yeah, I will. For now, I'm gonna try to do a quick processing of this. Okay, and here we are with some very, very quick processing, just like a few minutes. And I didn't even do any like color, photometric color calibration, simply because I couldn't figure out in this version of PixInsight how to do an astrophotography, an astrometric solution. But this is 20 minutes with this like automated telescope. I was not expecting this. This is much better, much better than what I expected. This is good. This is really promising, and now I'm really looking forward to using it under the stars of a much darker boreal zone than here in Tokyo. I mean, there is definitely a lot of potential, especially for people looking for a very portable setup. This is cool. This is not the best image ever, obviously, but this is really cool, and I'm looking forward to testing it some more. Please let me know what you think in the comments. I think Dwarf Lab is doing itself a disfavor, or shooting itself in the foot, by not having like a proper auto stretch of the image, because I'm sure that their live stack would look much better with a proper auto stretch. We'd likely see something close to that from Tokyo. And I mean, they are sitting on a gold mine, and they really need to remove the layer of crap that's around the gold nugget to really like show us what the telescope is looking for. So Dwarf Lab, I have like high expectations of you in terms of improving the software in there, because really I think you've done a great job for the hardware side of things, and a great job for the basic software, and now really comes like the difficult part. And that's pretty much what I wanted to cover in this video. So we saw that it's a decent toy for electronically assisted astronomy, and I feel like it can become a really good toy for that if we get like unlinked stretch. And as you can see here, it's a decent tool for astrophotography in remote places with like a tiny telescope. You just put it in a bag, go wherever you want, take like 30 minutes to 1 hour of exposures, and maybe like 10 dark frames. That's like what, in 2 minutes you can do that. And then you can bring it home and process that, and you'll get a decent result, especially if you went to a white zone. And the process to set up the system itself is like 20 seconds, right? There's nothing to do. This is good. This is really good. And it needs to be polished. We need to have this polished. This has so much potential. Oh, I'm gonna have fun with this. Okay, that's it for this video. Hopefully Dwarf Lab will look at this and will be able to kind of like enhance their software based on that. And thank you so much for watching. I hope that this was useful for you. I'm sorry I kept you waiting for so long for this first light, but I hope again that it gives you a good idea of what this telescope can achieve. With that, as always, thank you so much for watching. If you're new to the channel and you want to follow up on this telescope and my adventures, you may want to like the video, leave a comment, etc., etc., and subscribe as well. But more important than all of that, don't forget, whenever you can, to look up at the stars, and I'll see you next time.